why I was going to hell. I had people who told me why, if I didn't shape up, I was going to hell. There is no shaping up. There's no shaping up. You cannot shape up to be good enough for Jesus. You can't change your ways. People get mad at drug addicts. I was a drug addict. I was an alcoholic. I was a drug addict. I was a porn addict from 8. I was a drug addict from 11. My mom and dad got divorced when I was 11 years old, and they put me into the best place that they knew, which was a place called the Masonic Homes. So the Masonic organization, or the Masons, the Freemasons, raised me. So from when I was 11 years old, they put me in there because I was out of control. I was destructive. When mom and dad got divorced, I exploded, and my mom couldn't handle me. She was working 3 jobs, and my dad, like, he was from Vietnam, messed up, so he had trouble with holding jobs, and he just had trouble. It's not their fault. It's nobody's fault. Like, the whole thing is we're not supposed to blame people. I'm not supposed to blame my mom that she rejected me. We have relied so much on psychology that we've forgotten who God is. We have gone after the psychological approach to the gospel, and we've forgotten that the gospel is not psychological, it's supernatural. We have told people that the reason why they're rejected is because their mom said bad things about them when they were in the womb. What does that have to do, once you get born again, with your life or your identity? Your DNA doesn't depend upon your parents. See, the reality of you when you get saved, when you get born again, it means to be refathered. The DNA that you now receive from God is the divine nature of Abba. Listen, it's completely different. It is not scientific. It is supernatural. And if it is scientific, it's way beyond anything you could imagine. And it's way smarter than the smartest scientist that's out there. Scientists have discovered that the universe is expanding at the speed of light in every direction. Why? Because when God said go, he never said stop. And that God holds the universe in the palm of his hand, and he says he wants to fill you with his fullness. How can your mind wrap yourself around that? The only way your mind can wrap itself around that is that you would know that God wants to fill you with all of his fullness, and it's all according to the love of God that's in Christ Jesus. So the only way you could possibly wrap your mind about a God, around a God that created everything, that has the universe in the palm of his hand, that wants to fill you with his fullness, is to know the love of God that's in Christ Jesus. He made it very simple, yet so complex, it's out of scientists' minds. There's no possible way for them to figure it out, because the wisdom of God is way beyond the wisest person. And he uses the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. Like, the wise say, and the simple say, yay. Jesus said, become like a child or else you'll never enter in. Yet we've become so mature and grown up in church, but not really known him. And the beginning is knowing him. Jesus said, are you with me? Are you guys hanging with me still?
Amen.
2 Corinthians 11, Paul says this. I love it, because it's right after 2 Corinthians 10, which talks about our weapons. 2 Corinthians 10:4 says, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God, for pulling down strongholds, taking every thought captive. What does that mean? That means that every thought that tries to exalt itself up against the knowledge of God, you take captive, not by your own strength or your own worldly ways. And the worldly ways that I'm talking about right now is the psychological ways that seem right to a man. Because our weapons are not psychological, they're supernatural, they're divine, in God, mighty in God, for pulling down strongholds. See, a lot of people don't get into the Word and allow God's Word to come and cut and sift and train and trim and prune and mark you from inside out. But God wants to have his way with you. And people say that they love God, but you can't love God like you say you do until you Psalms 138 verse 2. You, O Lord, have magnified your word above your own name. So until you honor the infallibility of his word, you really don't love God. It's the truth. You can't say you love God but not honor the infallibility, unshakability, ultimate truth of God's word against every circumstance that you have. That doesn't mean that a circumstance or situation isn't real in your life. That just means that what God says is right and your circumstance didn't line up with it. That doesn't mean that God doesn't want it to. That means you press in until you get breakthrough, and that thing will be crushed because the word of God is like a hammer. You with me? Okay, because we're going to go after this thing.
Right.
I go after it every time because I believe that the body of Christ is in the middle of identity crisis. Mm. And if you don't know who you are, no one else will know who you are. And if they don't know who you are, then they'll never get to know who he is, because you were created in the image of God and in the likeness of God he made man. But man lost his identity in the garden and took on the nature of God's very own enemy. Took on the mindset of Satan himself. And we can't afford to think alongside of a thief that comes to steal, kill, destroy. We have to think according to a Father that so loved the world that he sent his Son, that whoever will believeth in him wouldn't perish, but have eternal life. And that word perish isn't just go to hell when you die. That word perish is right now having mental failure here. You can't afford to be crushed by the world. Jesus said, be of good cheer when you face tribulation. But the last thing that we have is cheer when we face tribulation, because we hate trials. Yet, Paul said, consider it a pure joy when you face these various trials. Peter, actually. Paul said, trials produce perseverance. Perseverance produces character. Character produces hope. How can you get to hope unless you go through a trial?
Amen.
Do you know that if you put somebody on fire in the fire, nothing changes? Do you know that when you put somebody that is on fire in the fire, nothing changes except you come out with a crisper, sharper, more awareness of who God is?
Mm.
But if you don't know who God is to begin with, you'll think that God's the one that sent the fire. What if God's not the one that sends the fire, but Satan comes to test to see if your faith is real? Come on, it says, don't think it's weird you face these various trials. It need be for the testing of your faith. But when you've gone through and you show yourself approved. Guys, there's this dross that's in there that needs to go. It needs to go. The only way it happens, Christian maturity isn't built in the garden, in the rosy garden, in the happy place. Christian maturity starts in the happy place, because if your secret place is your happy place, that's the only place to seek God. But Christian maturity grows because the fires are intense upon your life. And what if the problem is this? We don't know the tree that we are, so therefore the fruit that we have, we don't understand. See, when I squeeze an orange, what kind of juice comes out? Is there a question of whether orange juice comes out of an orange fruit? We're in Florida. Come on. Is there any chance that a different fruit comes out of an orange?
No.
So when you squeeze an orange, you get... Okay. All right. Well, we're in different places. I don't know if they have apple trees here. You could grow. But apple trees are usually in the fall when it's a little cooler. But where I came from in Pennsylvania, we have lots of apple trees. So apple trees produce apples. And the apples produce what kind of juice?
Apple juice.
That's exactly right. So an orange produces orange juice, and an apple produces apple juice. What if you watched me squeeze an orange? You ever see those orange juice machines, like at Whole Foods or whatever? They just go through and cycle through and squeeze. What if you poured a cup of that, or a quart of it, you took it home and drank it, and it was apple juice? What would you think? Look, this isn't a trick question. If you squeezed oranges into a jug and it was apple juice, what would you think? Would you drink it? It would be weird. So watch. It should be equally as strange that when a Christian gets squeezed, everything but Jesus comes out.
Amen.